Over Narendra Modi's comments just refuses to die down after the puppy analogy. A fresh outcry over his comments about the burqa or the veil comment. The Congress says the reference just exposes his real thinking and communal outlook. The Saffron Party, on the other hand, says the Congress is running out of excuses and hence trying to malign Narendra Modi. Whatever the case may be, one thing is for sure, the gloves have come off and both sides are ready for a big fight. But the crucial questions we'll be asking tonight are whether the Congress is letting Modi set the agenda. Is a Modi versus Congress election going to be an election about communalism versus corruption? That and more on tonight's NewsX debate. I am Athar Khan. Joining me tonight is Dilip Cherian, image guru and founder of Perfect Relations. Also joining me, Professor Madhav Nalpat, managing editor of the Sunday Guardian. D. Raja of the CPI also joined us, as does Sudhanshu Mittal of the BJP. Many thanks, all of you, for joining us at the NewsX debate. We'll also be joined in just a bit by Mr. Malai Swami, who's from the ADMK party from Tamil Nadu. I want to start the debate, if I could, with Mr. Madhav Nalapat, if I could. First up, we'll go to the Congress and the corruption versus the communalism card. But this particular speech in Pune, let's start with that briefly. He did get many of his facts wrong, and the Congress has been quick to pounce on that. Perhaps he went overboard by accusing the Congress of figures and facts that don't really exist.
Well, you know, the fact of the matter is that today Mr. Modi is in election mode. And the reality of the situation is that people judge a speech by the atmospherics, by the chemistry, by the electricity. Now, professors and analysts in television studios may judge every word of a speech. The public gets the raw electricity of the speech. Hmm. So I'm not at all certain that the kind of detailed points that people are talking about are really going to affect any public perception of that speech.
Okay, Dilip Cherian, coming to you. Is the Congress guilty of letting Narendra Modi set the agenda? Now, they gave a point-to-point rebuttal of whatever he said yesterday. But do you think they're letting their opponent, Mr. Narendra Modi, set the agenda and they're basically trapped in reactionary politics?
I think that reacting is good, and in politics, unless as Mr. Nalapat said, the electricity is countered by some kind of buffering, you're caught in a trap also of not doing anything, which, by the way, is what the Congress was doing till fairly recently. Hmm. Now that they are in the reactive mode, I think that Modi is riding that wave quite well. Hmm. Because he knows that he is surfing towards greater attention. Because each time that he provokes, they provoke back. And the real question is whether they can provoke enough to make him commit an error. An error in judgment at this stage is still reconcilable because he still has time. Hmm. Don't forget, you're at least 8 months away from what is the traditional date of elections. So he has room to make a mistake, but he's also benefiting from this ping-pong battle. But they're also doing it for one more reason. They don't want to make it a Modi versus X person. So it's the party versus Modi.
The party reacts as a whole, as one entity.
And except for some outliers, and Digvijay Singh is one of those outliers.
Right.
Except for some outliers, they seem to be fairly clear. Modi, on the other hand, seems to be like a field marshal, and everybody in the BJP is singing exactly the Modi tune. Nobody wants to cross over.
Okay, let's get a Congress reaction right now. Dr. Ami Yagnik joins us from Gujarat. He's the senior leader of the Congress party. Do you think that attacking Modi as a party, the BJP is saying, and this is what the BJP has been saying ever since Mr. Modi became campaign poll chief, Dr. Yagnik, that the Congress's days are numbered. It cannot hide behind the mass of corruption that the past 9.5 years have seen. Now, do you think it is going to be a communalism versus governance versus corruption sort of an election, or do you think the real issues lie somewhere else?
At the moment, I think these are not the issues at all on the card. If you see, the whole debate has sparked because of those statements which have been made by Mr. Modi. First of all, the students at Pune, the Ferguson College, did not deserve to be told about some political agenda. They were students merely listening to a chief minister of a state. He should have addressed them as a learned person to the students' community, gave them the right facts instead of bringing the political angle. That is the first point. The second point is that he very cautiously uses the words which he really wants to use, and so he has deliberately used the words which would spark off a debate. So this is not an election issue we are talking about here. It's just that the Congress is telling that why does he do this every time, because he does it very cautiously and with a motive. And so it's just a response that is being given by the Congress party as a whole. And so do not read too much into it, saying that it's an election issue. The other issues are already there. There can be debates on that. But this is because continuously, every day, something or the other is put in the media by Mr. Modi by speaking at public forums, very well designed and planned.
Okay.
This was not a political party he was addressing. He was addressing students at Ferguson College.
Okay.
And so he should have been very cautious as a learned person if
okay.
he was talking about his party.
Okay, Sudhanshu Mittal, Sudhanshu Mittal, Dr. Ami Yagnik has a point, and I think it's a fair one, that Mr. Modi is shrewd enough and capable enough of putting these bites or sound bites into the media, because he ultimately benefits from being in the news constantly, and also concerns about the language he uses. Now, do you think, as some critics have said about Mr. Modi, that his language somehow betrays the real Narendra Modi? What do you have to say to that?
Thank God he's talking, because the Prince Charming is not traceable. Only 2 days back he was returning from London. So at least we have a leader who's addressing issues before the people. Now, how he addresses them is something which, let it be his domain and not the domain of the Congress to tell him how he should be addressing students from Ferguson College. Having said so, let's start with this entire bizarre argument I just heard. One of the Congress spokesmen saying Gujarat has won only 7 medals out of 1,000 medals in national game. So if they haven't won medals in the national game, they have a right to be looted in the CWG games. Now, next, let's talk about the puppy incident. He makes a reference in a metaphorical manner to the events of 2002. Market, the question was, how do you react to the events of 2002? Now, the event of 2002 also contained the burning of Kar Sevaks in Godhra in the Sabarmati Express case. Now, is it the case of all those who have been crying foul about his statement that he was trying to demean the Kar Sevaks who were burned alive in the Sabarmati Express incident by referring to them as puppies? If this was not the case, then I rest my case.
Okay, Mr. Mittal, you made your point.
I think
you defended the question pretty well. Okay, Mr. Mittal, I think you defended. No. I'll come back to you, sir. You know I always come back to you, Mr. Mittal.
Just one more. Okay.
I'll come back to you. Mr. D. Raja is also with us. D. Raja is a senior leader from the CPI. Mr. Raja, what the BJP is saying, and every leader from the BJP, every spokesperson of the BJP defending Mr. Modi on television or otherwise will tell you this, that Mr. Modi can say no wrong, he can do no wrong. It's the Congress party, it's the opponents of the BJP and Mr. Modi, it's Modi baiters that see their own explanations in whatever Modi says. Do you agree with that? Do you think that Mr. Modi can do no wrong, say no wrong?
No, firstly, we should understand, what is BJP? BJP is a right-wing political party in India. It is the political arm of RSS, whose ideology is Hindutva, which is nothing but a sectarian, divisive ideology. I may call it fascist communal ideology. And right-wing leaders are always good in using demagogy.
I was waiting
demagogy.
Let him finish, sir. Yes.
No. Wait. They are good in using demagogy. Having said that, I would like to ask you, India is not a bipolarity. We do not have two-party system. Don't project the public discourse as one between Congress versus BJP. Thanks to Dr. Ambedkar, we have a Republican constitution. We are a multi-party democracy, a parliamentary democratic system. Here, both Congress and BJP have failed the nation. They have failed the people. They have betrayed the confidence of the people. Mr. Modi attacks Mr. Prime Minister Manmohan Singh for price rise. inflation, decline in the value of Indian rupee, so and so. But I would like to ask BJP, what is their alternative policy? Do you say think BJP and Congress are different on economic policies? I hardly believe there is no difference between Congress and BJP on economic policies, fiscal policies. Where is the difference between BJP and Congress on economic and fiscal policies,
Mr.
particularly macro level economic and fiscal policies? What is the public discourse we are having today? Congress versus BJP.
Mr. Raja, the point is, I'll go to Professor Nalpathan right now. Coming back to the point, really. But Mr. Mittal is laughing, I know, but Mr. Raja also has a point, sir, and you're defending your party, Mr. Raja is defending his. But let me come to Professor Nalpathan first, then I'll come back to you in just a bit. Professor Nalpathan, speaking about Modi every day, I mean, we as journalists seem to be speaking only about Modi and whatever he says. I'm going to put the same question to you again. Do you think that he needs to be more careful about the kind of language he uses, especially on public platforms? Like Dr. Yagnik pointed out, he was addressing a group of students and he didn't really have to take them so politically, on that, down that road. But he did, and he has the right to. But do you think he should be careful about the language he chooses?
Well, I think that, you know, every politician has to be careful about the language that is chosen. But so far as Narendra Modi is concerned, I think a lot of meanings are read into every statement of his. Now, for example, that puppy remark. Now, I've been to Gujarat quite a few times. If I'm not mistaken, I mean, I don't know Gujarati, but I think there's something called Kurkuria, which is little puppy. And Gujaratis regard that as a synonym for something very innocent. And they use that reasonably frequently when they refer to some innocent individuals and innocent lives. So it was not out of context for someone who's actually really, you know, very grounded in Gujarati to use that expression. And to say that this refers to a particular community, in my view, is insulting that particular community. There is absolutely, I mean, it's absolutely ridiculous to say that it refers to a particular community. It, I mean, in my view, it's been taken completely out of context. It could also be because there may be translations of it in other languages.
Right.
And the Reuters interview was in English.
Okay.
So I have no idea what the translations were.
Going away from the puppy analogy, that seems to be old news. Let me ask you, Dilip Charian, do you think Narendra Modi is trapped in his own polarizing image? So no matter what he says, whatever he might mean, people have a tendency to take it and look at it through the prism of say his past or 2002 or whatever it is that they wanted to run him for.
What people are not perhaps watching, because as you rightly said, the media is obsessed with analyzing Modi. And even in that analysis, if you look at the way he's playing his image, there was Modi version 1.0, which was Modi, the leader of Gujarat. Then there's Modi 2.0, which was unleashed about 5 months ago, which is Modi, leader of the BJP. Now what you got to wait and watch is Modi, leader of the nation, which is a card he's going to play post Diwali this year. And he's putting all the agenda points for that. And one of the big agenda points for it is, of course, youth, corruption, development. But the real question is how big a component of it is the communalism card. So if Modi wants to win elections, he knows that this time around, and you know, the 2014 elections are pretty much decisive where this is concerned. But I have, you know, I have a longer theory on that. But version 3.0 of Modi, which will be unleashed post Diwali this year, will have, and what proportion of communalism will it have? These are the only two questions, and that's a winning card for Modi.
Are you saying, Mr. Charian, that the debate for 2014 or the discourse for 2014 should not be about governance or corruption? It should be about communalism or secularism? And which way do you think it will go, given the facts that we are seeing today?
You know, this is a sad fact, but the Indian electorate does not, like the American electorate, believe that it's the economy stupid, which is where corruption comes in. So the link between corruption and a decrepit economy, which is what the Congress, which is what the UPA is leaving us with, is not being made clear even by Modi. So if Modi is able to deconstruct that and say corruption equals a bad economy, then he, and if he throws that into the pot of Modi version 3.0, he might balance out communalism. But at the moment, what he's playing for, and you can see that with the burqa comment and the puppy comment, however it's interpreted, is heading in the direction of a higher dose of communalism.
Okay, do you agree with that, Dr. Amin Yagnik, that Modi is actually playing towards that card, and all these comments are carefully orchestrated, and he actually has a plan? I'll come to you, Mr. Mittal. I know you want to say something, but first, Dr. Yagnik, do you think that this sort of balanced communalism that he wants to really test out and see how far he can go, do you think that's the case? And do you think, as the Congress's critics say, that the Congress is trying to hide behind the corruption of 9.5 years, that's why it keeps bringing the secularism card?
I can't hear. I am unable to hear.
Okay, if you can hear me, I'm going to repeat the question. The Congress's critics say that the Congress is trying to malign Mr. Modi because it is trying to hide behind 9.5 years of corruption. That is why you keep playing the secularism v. communalism card. Okay, there seems to be some audio trouble. We'll try.
I can't hear your question.
Right, there seems to be some audio trouble. I'll come back to you, Dr. Yagnik, if I can. D. Raja first, then we come to you then. You heard what Dilip Cherian had to say. He said that Mr. Modi is trying to calibrate his...
How about me?
I'll come to you, sir. I always come back to you.
Let me get a reaction.
Let me get a reaction from D. Raja, then I'll come to you, Dr. Mittal, Mr. Mittal. D. Raja, you heard what Dilip Cherian had to say. He's saying that Modi 3.0 is about to be unleashed, and he will try and see what dose of communalism really can he use for his own benefit. Do you see that going in that direction?
Firstly, it is BJP and the project leader, Mr. Modi, try to vitiate the entire social situation in the country. They want to polarize. They want to divide the people on communal lines. And whenever BJP is desperate, BJP falls back to its old agenda of Hindutva. And BJP talks everything it up, but people have their own tragic experience. They have seen 1992. They have seen 2002 Gujarat. Let us try to understand. Now, my question is, you ask BJP also this question, if BJP resorts to communal agenda, let them speak out honestly. When they question the Congress party, what is their alternative program? Whether they are in a position to give something to the people, to save the economy.
Okay, Mr.
Mittal. To control the prices.
Mr. Mittal.
To control the inflation.
Okay.
Because they have no alternative policy, they resort to communalism. They want to divide the people on communal lines.
Okay, Mr.
That
Mittal.
That is what I am trying to say.
Mr. Mittal.
People may laugh,
yeah,
but I will have the last laugh.
Let me get a reaction from him, from the BJP, Mr. Raja. Mr. Mittal, communalism and hyping up right-wing sentimentalism or patriotism, whatever you want to call it, is your go-to card, is what the CPI says, also your detractors in the Congress. Do you agree with that? Do you think that you don't have an alternative for what the Congress has given the country for 8.5 years? Do you?
First thing, about what Mr. Raja said, does it really merit a comment?
It does, sir, because you are...
I think the people of this country have already passed their verdict on Mr. Raja.
It does merit a comment, sir.
Reducing... Allow me, because the people of this country have reduced this party to two MPs just because of this. Because I do not know whether they have made up their mind on which side of the fence they are. Are they allies with the Congress or they are opposing the Congress? I don't know. Acha. Let me come down to the most...
We are opposing BJP. We are clear, we are opposing BJP. You have no alternative program.
Allow me now. Sir, you spoke, I did not speak. Sir, when you spoke, I did not speak.
Okay.
So let's have courtesy towards each other.
Go ahead.
Okay. Now, what an irony. These so-called secular parties have only been talking communalism. They've been talking Hindu, they've been talking Muslim, they've been talking rights. And the so-called communal party like us have only been talking development. We've been talking governance, we've been talking about a corruption-free state, we've been talking about price rise, we've been talking about dollar, we've been talking about women's security, we've been talking about national security. So what an irony, first. Secondly, I just want to ask all my friends here, what is the context to the communal politics we are discussing today? the so-called allegation against Mr. Modi are the events of 2002, after which this nation has witnessed two Lok Sabha elections in 2004-2009, and we are heading the third one. This state has witnessed three Lok Sabha Vidhan Sabha elections, and the gentleman is in power after having obtained the mandate of the people of Gujarat. So, and look, who is raising the issue of communalism? A party which massacres six in Delhi in 84 and punishes nobody for that, they're talking about communalism. A party which joins hands with MIM in Andhra Pradesh.
Those wrongs don't make a right, sir. What happened in 84 was wrong, about, absolutely wrong. But what happened
Allow me to finish. A party which says in Mizoram that we aspire for a Christian state is talking about secularism and accusing of us communalism. A party which joins hands with Kerala Congress, which is a Christian outfit in Kerala, they are talking about secularism and accusing us of being communal. Look, this nation has heard, rejected.
Why is secularism a bad word for the BJP?
The concept of secularism.
Why is secularism a bad word for the BJP, sir? Why is secularism a bad word?
Look, let me explain. Because for us, this secularism is not secularism. For us, secularism means justice for all, appeasement to none. And if this is not secularism, and if your secularism is appeasement to A, B, C, D, then we reject this secularism. Look, we've seen, what Bagla Bhagat is a word. You know, you mean something, you attack something else. Today's problem is that Congress is besieged with the problem of governance. The corruption index has been at all-time high this nation has ever witnessed. Hundreds and thousands of crore have lost relevance. Today it is lakhs of crores of corruption. These are the dimensions. Look at the prices. Where have they reached? Look at what is happening to the dollar. The economy is in shambles.
Okay,
look
okay,
at
Mr.
what
Mittal,
is happening to security,
point.
Be it internal security,
Mr.
be it
Mittal,
national security, be it external
regulation. You made your point.
So the real issue is that they want to deflect attention.
Yeah. Okay,
they want to deflect election attention from the real issues confronting this nation and talking about the bogey of corruption of communalism, which has no context, which has just no relevance and no context. By merely talking corruption communalism, you will never be able to establish a context in this country, because this country has seen through this game.
Okay,
this
Professor
country
Nalpat.
Needs governance.
Okay,
this
okay, Mr. Mittal, one second. Professor Nalpat, is it so bad to discuss secularism versus communalism? I mean, isn't secularism in our constitution, like some Congress leaders today said? Why is the BJP, why does it get so, I can't find the right word except for irritated whenever this debate about the communal roots of the BJP or the RSS or so-called communal roots of the BJP and the RSS and Mr. Modi's previous, the past and the ghost that haunt him, whenever that comes up for debate, why is the BJP so afraid of the word secularism?
No, Athar, I think, you know, the point of the matter is that communalism is evil, religious fundamentalism is evil, and religious exclusivism and what is called religious supremacy, that one religion is superior to other, is totally evil. But that applies across the board. Hmm. And it is very important to ensure that every community respect the rules of secularism. If, let us say, you have a situation in which some players can do what they like and some players are supposed to be bound by rules, you have a problem in the game. So what is very important in India is that the same standards should be applied to the leaders of every single community. Hmm. And this is the point which I think, you know, frankly, which I think the narrative which is playing into Mr. Narendra Modi's hands, that there is a different standard for communalism in one community and a different standard for communalism in the other community. Hmm. And I think this is definitely playing into his hands. And quite obviously, being a very shrewd politician, without saying anything, he's taking advantage of it. Now, I'd like to make another point. That is, he has become the issue. It has become a presidential election. Hmm. Narendra Modi as the presidential stroke prime ministerial candidate. Hmm. If he can convert this election into a presidential election, and in at least 400 constituencies, if the battle is seen as between Narendra Modi and the rival candidate, not between the BJP candidate but Narendra Modi and the rival candidate, he has got a very substantial advantage.
Right.
That is what happened to Indira Gandhi. The election was seen as Indira Gandhi versus everybody else.
Right, right.
Today it's being seen as Narendra Modi versus everybody else. So frankly, Mr. Modi's best friends are people like, frankly, in the CPI, Congress Party and others, who are making him the center of their discourse.
Is it going to be a Modi versus the rest election? If that happens, does Modi stand a very good chance of actually going where he wants to go?
If it's Modi versus the rest, then Modi's seat count, which is what I call the Modi's personal seat count, could be as high as 50 within the basket of whatever the BJP makes. And that is a very critical number. And that is the number which could decide whether he is prime minister in 2014 or whether he can play for prime minister in 2015.
Right.
Don't forget the sweepstakes are not over in 2014.
Yeah.
And that is the thing most analysts are forgetting. That 2014 is just election results, but if Mr. Modi has 50 of his own candidates by the process of what Professor Nalapat talked about of making it presidential, then those candidates are his and not necessarily those of an NDA or whatever combination comes to power.
D. Raja, yes, go ahead.
Firstly, I must respond to some of the observations made by Ms. Nalapat. We are opposed to all shades of communalism, religious fundamentalism. We do not compromise with one communalism or we don't oppose the other communalism. We are opposed and we have been fighting. It is the history of CPI. It is the history of left. I must make it clear. Secondly, I started my intervention saying don't make it this public discourse as one between Congress and BJP. We are not having a two-party political system. Then some people were laughing and I must laugh at them now. Do we have a two-party system in India? We are a multi-party system. We do not elect president directly and we do not elect prime minister directly. How come certain parties projecting some individuals as prime minister?
Mr. Raja, don't you think that's where the people opposing Mr. Modi and the BJP seem to make the mistake that they in fact are letting him set the agenda and trying to oppose him are letting him do exactly what he wants, and like Professor Nalapat said, playing right into his hands. Don't you think the Congress, of course, is the biggest party opposing the BJP and Mr. Modi's elevation to the national stage? Don't you think they should set the agenda instead of reacting to everything Mr. Modi and the BJP says and does? Mr. Raja, that question is for you.
For me,
what agenda can they set?
Mr. Raja, please respond. I'll come to you, Mr. Mittal.
They have a such a dismal record.
Let Mr. Raja respond, sir. I'll come to you. Yes, Mr. Raja. Why don't you set the agenda? Why doesn't the Congress set the agenda? Why play into Mr. Modi's hands and not make it about communalism or secularism? Make it about governance. Is the Congress and the UPA afraid to do that?
Exactly. This is what Congress should understand. Instead of attacking Ms. Modi and BJP only on communal plank, Congress should answer to certain economic issues. Why there is price rise? Why there is inflation? Why there is unemployment? Why Indian rupee is falling like this in an unprecedented way? Congress should come forward explaining these questions. Here, I think when BJP attacks Congress party for all these economic evils or the problem economic problems, what is the alternative program from BJP? And both parties do not offer anything for the common people. That is where I think there is a space for other parties. You discuss other parties and don't laugh. This is not a laughing matter. This is a serious issue. You media also should understand. You are misleading the public discourse.
There must be a logic why the two biggest national parties in India.
Can I say
hopefully they're not composed of complete fringe lunatics. Understand that this country fortunately or unfortunately, the majority of this country, fortunately or unfortunately, do not vote on economic issues. They vote on what I call petty caste and communal issues. Those are what I call the primitive drivers of voting patterns. That is why the two biggest parties in this country play on that.
Right, Mr. Mittal, unfortunately, Indian voter doesn't say it's the economy stupid, has never said it, and according to Mr. Cherian, perhaps might not say that in 2014 as well.
Is the
caste or something else?
Allow me to explain that also.
Yes, yes, but briefly, sir.
That's not historically true.
But briefly, sir, please go ahead. Yes, Mr. Mittal.
Can I answer this?
Yes, Mr. Mittal, please, briefly, sir.
You are undermining the intelligence of the Indian voter. Look, there was a time when we used to say that you do not cast your vote, you vote your caste. Because there was primacy of caste in the late 90s and the early 20s. Post-2008, the polity of this country has had a course correction. People and governments who have performed have been voted back to power. Be it Madhya Pradesh, be it Chhattisgarh, be it Gujarat, be it Bihar, a host lot of them.
Be it UPA1.
There is now a premium on governance. In fact, people are raising the issues of governance. Just allow me to finish. 2007 UP, you have a change on the issue of governance. 2012 UP, you have a change on the issue of governance. And what people perceive as the outfit which can deliver. So please, there is a section which goes for the caste. Caste is important, but not absolute. In today's politics, the politics of hope, the politics of delivery, the politics of performance has become paramount. And that is what is going to be the guiding principle for the next vote also.
Okay.
And it is for this reason that BJP has been talking about the politics of development.
Okay.
We have been talking about the politics of governance. We have been talking about corruption. We have been talking about price rise.
Right.
We have been talking about
what
dollar price.
Politics,
we have been talking about security.
Okay, Mr. Mittal.
Because these are the real
issues.
Let
me remind you, sir.
People have realized that caste is not what is the ultimate. And the likes of Mr. Raja. And the likes of Mr. Raja are dated in history. They are frozen in the time span of history.
Come on, now we know what is history. Don't try to teach me
India.
Gentlemen, give me a second. Mr. Raja, I'll let you respond as well. But Professor Nalpat, really, do you think... Mr. Mittal gave a very, very impressive speech, I must say that. But isn't the UPA also saying the same thing, that we've performed for 8.5 years? We've delivered on this, we delivered on... C3 and even Shashi Tharoor, the junior minister, asked based on our performance. Now the Congress says that we are. BJP says the same thing.
Really?
The BJP says the same thing. The poor voter, me, who does he listen to?
Well, you know, allow me to have half a second to say that I share Mr. Raja's view that the left parties have stood against communalism in all its forms. Mm. I wasn't really referring to that record. I was referring to some other aspects of discourse. But having said that, I am not entirely certain that the UP elections have been the issue of governance. Mm. My own view is that UP caste grounds. And it is caste that has been a very important caste and community that's been a very important determinant.
It's not just the Hindi heartland. Even the southern states vote on caste.
If performance had ruled, Chandrababu would not have lost Andhra.
Okay.
He had really performed.
Very, very important.
Or Mayawati, for that matter.
Or
frankly,
Mayawati for that
Mayawati's
matter.
Government was much better than government.
Right.
Version 3, and if I may say so, he would be the first really viable prime ministerial candidate from not only a backward community, but the backwards of the backward.
Okay, let's get a fresh perspective. I apologize to K. Malai Swami of the ADMK for making him wait, and he has no time. Mr. Mittal, please. Mr. Mittal, let's get a fresh perspective on this debate. K. Malai Swami, what do you think about Mr. Modi? Is Mr. Modi, you being from the ADMK, a party from the south of India, let's get a fresh southern perspective in. Is Mr. Modi the right choice for the country? What are your views on that?
Now, I mean, he is being figured as a prime minister candidate or whatever it is. I mean, whatever the other parties, there is no chance of compare and contrast. Let us wait for some more time and I will react afterwards.
Okay, that's a very diplomatic answer, sir. But coming back to the debate right now, Mr. Raja, I'll come to you in just a bit. Let me go to Mr. Mittal first. But Mr. Mittal, please keep it brief. I don't have much time on the debate, but Mr. Mittal, go ahead.
Okay. Atta, just one more thing. We just talked about UP. Let me enlighten my friends here. Mr. Akhilesh Yadav gets 224 seats. If caste was the reason why he got voted in, then Muslims and Yadavs could not have hoped to get more than 123 seats. If you look at the caste dynamics of each seat, the fact that he got 224, the fact that Mayawati got 207, speaks volumes of the fact that while caste is important, it is something beyond caste which makes them become successful. And that beyond caste theory is the theory of hope, the theory of governance, the theory of desire of alternate government which can deliver. So let's not undermine the wisdom of the Indian electorate. We seem to be really stereotyping the reactions of the Indian electorate in terms of their preferences. As I said, caste is important, but no. Today, after 6 decades of India's independence, people have realized that they need to go beyond caste, and it is for this reason that they vote for governments which deliver, they boot out governments which do not deliver, and unfortunately and fortunately, in the present context, the perception of governance in the central government is pathetic. On all counts, people are disappointed, dismayed, and it is for this reason that they have nearly lost faith on the entire democratic process of this country. The entire polity today stands convicted in the eyes of people. And that is the real issue.
So corruption and governance are the major issues that the BJP is going to fight 2014 on. Is that right?
Against this kind of polity.
So corruption and governance is what you're saying the BJP will focus on. The corruption by the UPA for 8.5 years, the misgovernance,
absolutely,
like you say.
Absolutely.
And there's nothing else that Mr. Modi will appeal to? Is that what you're saying?
We have not decided on Mr. Modi yet, so let's not assume
But he's going to steer your campaign, sir. You have decided on him.
And we have an enviable track record. We have Gujarat. Allow me. We have Gujarat, we have Madhya Pradesh, we have Chhattisgarh to showcase our successes.
Okay.
We have plenty of track record to say we will give you good governance.
Okay.
We'll give you corruption-free governance.
Okay.
And it is for this reason that this nation is going to believe in
BJP. Okay, Mr. Raja, do you agree with Mr. Sudhanshu Mittal? He says that BJP has the right alternative. They've shown it in MP, they've shown it in Chhattisgarh, they've shown it in Gujarat. Now, they have three models in front of us. Now, they're saying this is the alternative. This is what we want to do with the country.
No, firstly, I must say, I have heard enough of rabid anti-communist rhetorics in history. Let no one teach me history, number one. Number two, what is Gujarat model of development? You ask any economist in the country who is living in Delhi or in other cities, what is their opinion, assessment of Gujarat economy? Take any human development index. Gujarat is one of the lowest. It is not even closer to the national average. If at all Gujarat, somebody gained, it is corporate sector. Why not accept this reality? Having said that, I must also underline one more fact.
Amazing,
it is not going to be 2014.
Raja.
It's not. Listen to
Mr.
me.
Raja,
don't interrupt.
Okay, Mr. Mittal,
speak.
Please,
you
don't interrupt.
You.
Let him speak. Let him speak. Go ahead.
You have
why
that decency
I mean,
to listen to others. You have
without any substance.
No. Mr. Mittal, we were patient when you were talking, sir.
You
very patient.
Listen to me.
Please be patient, sir.
Mr. Mittal, please be patient.
You're not being fair. Please be patient, sir. Mr. Raja, go ahead.
Let them not interrupt me.
Yes, please go ahead, sir. Nobody's interrupting
you. 2014 election or 2013 elections are not going to be one Congress versus BJP. There are non-Congress, non-BJP parties which do matter in this country. Regional parties do matter in this country. And there is definite space for non-Congress, non-BJP parties. Let us not take people for granted. Let us not take politics for granted. So let us have confidence in the maturity of our people. They will give the verdict. And these rhetorics, this demagogy cannot bring results. It is people who are going to deliver the verdict.
Okay. Dilip Cherian, I mean, he has a point. I mean, we can't just write off regional parties. But coming back to Mr. Modi and the furore he has created over his recent comments. First, the puppy analogy. Now, the BJP says it's the Congress's mindset that makes the puppy analogy even an issue. Then came the burqa comment. Now, do you think that, as some people say, that this is carefully, calibrated speech making, and nothing that Mr. Modi says doesn't go through his speech makers or whatever. He knows exactly what he's saying and who exactly is he catering to. Do you believe that, first of all?
I think that Mr. Modi is very, very calculated and careful in his comments. Even when he seems to react, even when he goes to his highest voice pitch, as you can say, he plays with several voice pitches, and as in Perfect Relations we do image studies of voice recordings of leaders, and even when he goes to his peak voice, he's very careful about the words he chooses. For example, he could easily have used gungat instead of burqa, but he chose to use burqa. So communalism, casteism, which, as Dr. Nalapat said, could be brought into play later, and corruption. If you take these three C's, it's a very powerful combination in favor of Mr. M. So
that was communalism, corruption,
and casteism.
Yeah. Now, that could be a potent mix for 2014.
Absolutely.
Okay, we'll have to see, though.
How much of that, and he has to calibrate how much of that he's going to put into version 3.0. In this version, corruption and governance go together. So that takes care of Mr. Mittal's point. Now, the fact is that, does this country vote that way? There's only one nigger in the woodpile. And that nigger is, how will the young vote? Because the young voter is something we haven't discussed or debated just now. Will the young voter go in a different trajectory and create a new direction and create history by voting for change that means something to his future or her collective future? That's the question I don't
have.
Which way
do you think the youth will swing if they do rise above the three C's?
My reading is that the youth will take the corruption part of the C more seriously and more committedly than anyone else.
Okay.
So there is a real danger as far as the current government is concerned.
So interesting, Dilip Cherian. He could have used the word gungat, but he didn't. Now, that says a lot as well. But unfortunately, we're out of time on this debate. I would have loved to continue this debate. I must thank all my guests who, in their spirited discussion, livened up this debate. And my apologies, sir, I'm out of time, sir. I'm really sorry I'm out of time. We stretched this debate already. My apologies to anyone who felt bad about any of the other guests. I must thank Mr. D. Raja, Mr. Sudhanshu Mittal, Professor Madhav Nalapat, Mr. K. Malai Swami, also Dr. Ami Yagnik, as well as Dilip Cherian, for joining me on the NewsX debate tonight. That's all the time we had on the NewsX debate. I'm Athar Khan. You make your own decisions, India. Good night.